to close your eyes for just a moment. Clear your mind of everything. And imagine sunlight falling on a vast green lawn. And imagine that there are some trees shading the lawn. Now imagine that off in the distance, you see a number of people of all ages, all sizes, all races, walking around among the trees, along the yard, along the lawn. And as you go closer to them, as you draw closer to them, you see that they are walking in the midst of what looks like stones, boulders, rocks. And then as you get closer and closer, you realize these are no stones, rocks, or boulders, but they are hewn items that look like tombstones, headstones. And now you realize that this vast lawn, this sun-bathed lawn, and the shaded trees are in a cemetery. It might be Sunset Memorial Park up on Harper Road, or Blue Ridge Memorial Gardens out at Prosperity, but you are in a cemetery. And as you draw even closer and closer, some of the people you see, their faces come into focus, and they look familiar to you, but not quite totally familiar. Some of them look like older versions of people that you know. Younger versions of people that you may know, or even of yourself. And as you draw closer, you come to this one tombstone, and on the stone is written your name. And now you realize you are in the future. You have passed away and gone. And the people who are milling around, walking around, are your family, your children, your grandchildren now grown, their children and grandchildren.
Go ahead.
And you begin listening to them talk. And some of the younger children are looking at this tombstone and seeing a name and wanting to know, who was this person? What were they like? Why are they important? Why are we here? And this is when you begin to hear your own relatives, your children, your grandchildren, explain to their children and grandchildren who you were and what your life meant to them. So you can open your eyes now and consider for yourself, what are you going to hear them say? What kind of person were you that they are going to remember and that they are going to pass on to their own children and to their grandchildren as to who you are, who you were. So often in life, as you pointed out in that inspirational reading I did, so often we move through life in such a way that we have all these goals in mind and all these aspirations in mind of having the best job and the best education and the best this and the best that and the nicest home and whatever. And somehow we seem to believe that those are the things that matter. We build up all kinds of treasures. I have a habit of collecting books. I have a huge library. The folks who have been helping me move have been very, very vocal about you should throw some of this stuff away.
You're in good company here.
Have you ever read all these books? No, but I'm going to. Okay. But, and people have other things that they collect. My mother collects dolls. We have a whole room full of dolls that aren't going to do any good to anybody after she's gone, but they're there. And we all have different things we put our hearts and minds on and what we want out of life. And don't always realize that those are the things that are going to pass away, that are not going to make any difference later on to other people. What other people are going to remember is who we were. Sometimes we think that by giving more money to a charity or to a school or whatever, and having our name on a building or a plaque or a statue is what matters. So at Lloyd Fairfax Community College, where I taught for the past 8 years, they have been going through a renovation project over the past few years. And last year, or the year before last, they renamed the main building, the welcome center that goes into where you go into the main hall. And they called it, it used to be just be called Welcome Center. Now it has a name, Toxopius. And Toxopius, T-O-X-O-P-E-U-S, is actually a surname of a Greek immigrant who is a longtime board member of Lloyd Fairfax Community College, who guided them through the fundraising program for this renovation project, donated $5 million of his own money towards the project, and also helped establish the education fund there. So, the building is named after him. Most of us faculty and students who came up one day and saw that name, new name upon the building, were asking, who the heck is Toxopius? Or what? Because we couldn't figure out what it was. Except that there was a press release explaining who the guy is. Now, I'm willing to bet that all new students coming in the next year are not going to know who Toxopius was or what Toxopius is or even care. Now to him, that was an important thing. To the school, it was important. But over time, people are going to forget that. They're going to forget that name. They're going to forget why it's up there. They're going to forget what he did. Sometimes the things we did, some people may remember in one way and over time, other people may remember in a different way. So those of you that are going to New Orleans in a couple of, in that week, you know that New Orleans, along with Richmond and Charlottesville, and now St. Louis, and a number of other places, have been dismantling monuments to Confederate heroes. At one time, there were those people who wanted to remember those guys for whatever it was they did, but 150 years later, we have a very different way of remembering. And so, we no longer remember those people the way those folks who put those statues up remember them. We have people today who are being honored for so many different things, and Academy Awards, Grammys, whatever. In 20 or 30 years, how many of us will remember who those people were or what it was they did? It's not the things we focus upon, the things that we acquire, the homage that we seek, that gives us our treasure, but the person that we are inside. Now, some of you all who may remember, if you have read your Bible at some point in time, that in Jesus' time, during in the Gospels, there were people who felt that the only way to have value, the only way to have moral value, the only way to have lasting value was to follow all the rules of religion. One of those rules happened to be that whenever you ate dinner, or particularly festival dinners like Passover, you had to wash your hands. Okay. Jesus and his disciples had this habit of breaking the rules all the time. They would go out and pick corn on the Sabbath, which they weren't supposed to do, because they were hungry. They would sit down to eat because they were hungry, and they would neglect doing the hand washing ritual. Okay? They would sit with people who were considered unclean, tax collectors, prostitutes, beggars, all these other people. And the group of people called the Pharisees, who wanted to obey all the rules, who felt that was the only way to be a true person of God, would criticize them. So one time they came and criticized Jesus and his disciples for not washing their hands. And Jesus' response was, it's not what goes inside the body that makes the person unclean. It's what comes out of the heart. What comes out of the mind, because as you think, so it is in your heart, and as it is in your heart, so you will speak, and out of that comes all manner of unkindness, of hate, of murder, of vice, and other things. It isn't what goes in, it isn't the rules that you follow, in other words, what Jesus was saying, it isn't the rules you follow. It isn't whether you follow all the rules of life and do all the things that society expects of you and then you're going to be a great person. It's who you are inside that really determines the type of person that you are and the type of person that other people will remember long after. 500 years before Jesus, in a totally different part of the world, China, Confucius basically said the same thing. I don't know if any of you are familiar with Confucianism. Confucianism is very similar to a philosophy that the Greeks call virtue ethics, in which it isn't important what rules you follow of society to get ahead or to succeed or to be a success. Those things aren't what matter, but the person that you are, the character that you are. Confucius, like Jesus, said, it's not so important whether you follow all the rules of society, but whether you, inside your heart, inside your mind, have been able to tame the thoughts that are in your mind and be able to keep those in sync with your heart so that you can be a virtuous person. Confucius said this is something that you does not happen to you automatically, you must practice it. Just like you would practice learning all your manners and etiquette. So when you all were young and small kids, your parents taught you to say yes sir, no sir, thank you, please, pretty please with sugar on it, and whatever. And over time, as you practiced all those things, they become second nature to you. They actually become first nature to you. They become who you are. They become you. They become the person that you are. Confucius and Jesus both said that you don't acquire this automatically. You don't acquire virtue automatically. It is something you must harvest. It is something that you must grow. It is something you must practice. In your heart, in your mind, with your whole soul. Only then can you truly become the person that you really want to be and the type of person that others will emulate. The Greek Stoics had a way of looking at this. You probably heard the phrase, all the world is a stage and we are but the players thereon. Now most of us have heard it. Most of us, if we studied in high school and paid attention when we took Shakespeare, we know that comes from Hamlet. Shakespeare was a borrower of other people a great deal. He borrowed that from a Greek philosopher named Epictetus, who saw the whole world as nothing more than like a stage, a play. We are all a part of it. And each one of us had a part. Each one of us had a place in life. Each one of us had a part to play. And it is important for each of us to play that part as fully and nobly as we can, regardless of what comes against us, regardless of what illnesses, regardless of what tragedies, regardless of what difficulties may come against us. But to face those things with great strength and nobleness. Be the type of person that we should be, a person of strength, a person of honor, a person of integrity. And as we do that, as Epictetus said, as Confucius also said, when we live that type of virtuous life, then those around us will want to emulate us, will see that virtue in us, helping us to endure, and we'll want to be like that. Our children will want to emulate us. Our grandchildren will want to emulate us. Our society would want to emulate us. because we have set an example of the type of virtuous person that everyone has the possibility and the opportunity to become. So when your children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren are gathered around your tombstone and they're telling about you, hopefully they're going to say, how strong you were. They're going to say how kind you were. They're going to say how compassionate you were. They're going to say how noble you were and how much integrity you had to stand up for what you truly believed against all odds. That's the type of person that we want to become. Those are the things that matter. That's the type of person that we hope that others will